Welcome to M-Coding. Today, we're hitting a common problem with some recursive algorithms, causing them to fail on even moderately sized inputs. Let's say you have to traverse a tree in some way. The tree is made up of nodes that contain some data and zero or more child nodes. Let's take a dead simple recursive task, just printing out the nodes. Here's the whole implementation. Yes, it's that simple. We print out the current node, then loop over the children, recursing on each child. The order we're going in here is called a pre-order traversal, by the way. And it works. When we give it this small example, it prints out all the nodes in the expected order. First the root, then child 0, the three children of child 0, which are 00, 01, and 02, and then child 1 of the root. So great. All your tests pass, it's simple and readable, you ship it to production. And the second a client touches it, whammo-bammo, it instantly breaks. Surely, they must have passed a ginormous, unsightly pathological tree in order to break the perfection and elegance that is every line of code beget of your golden fingertips. Nope. They passed a linked list with 1,000 nodes in it. What went wrong is you hit the recursion limit, which is a mere 1,000 in Python by default. That's why the crash happens near 1,000 children. You can increase the recursion limit using sys.setRecursionLimit, but that doesn't really solve the problem. The recursion limit is there to fail early in the case when you accidentally cause an infinite recursion, so you can crash the program instead of running out of memory and crashing your whole computer. Increasing the limit a lot would defeat the purpose of having the limit. But only increasing it a little bit is just asking for the client to hand you a 2,000 node list in the future. So what do? We use this handy trick. The idea is to convert your recursive call stack into a literal call stack, making the entire function iterative, thereby completely bypassing any recursion limit problems. We'll use a list as the data structure for our stack. Append is pushing onto the stack, and pop is popping off the stack. We'll use a while stack to keep going as long as our stack is not empty. Then we indent this, and replace any recursive calls like this one with pushing onto the stack. Running our linked list example again, we see now it fully prints all the children down to child 999. But if we take a look at our first smaller example, we'll see that we've actually changed the order that nodes are printing in. Before, we had the root, then child 0, then 00, 01, and 02, finishing with child 1 last. And the reason for that is because a stack is a last-in, first-out data structure. The fix for this is that in our implementation, whenever we want to make multiple recursive calls, we actually need to put them on the stack in reverse order, so they go in the intended order when we pop them off the stack. So we just loop over each node's children in reverse order. Then we're back to the same output as before. We now have an equivalent function to the original recursive implementation that prints out our nodes and that works no matter how deep a tree you pass it. But you may be wondering, what if I had a more complex recursive function that doesn't just have a single node parameter like this one? Let's say I wanted to add a max depth to my print. In the recursive case, that means checking if we've hit the max depth and not recursing if we have. Otherwise, we do recurse and pass each child one less max depth. To make the iterative version, we do the same trick as before, but instead of just putting the current node on the stack, we'll put a tuple of whatever arguments we were going to pass to the recursive call. We start by making a stack with the initial arguments to the function. Then we do a while stack, pop off an element from the stack, and unpack the variables. Popping the tuple off the stack and assigning to these variables restores all of them to a state just like we would have had if we'd made a recursive call. Once again, we indent. An early return in the recursive implementation just means that we don't want to do any more work in this iteration. So in the stack version, that just becomes a continue, which will skip and process the next item on the stack. Then we replace recursive calls with just pushing onto the stack any arguments that we were going to pass to the recursive call. And as before, we need to put those things on the stack in the reverse order. And now our max depth parameter is working. A max depth of 0 just means printing the root. If we have a depth of 1, then we'll use the root and its children, but we don't recurse to their children. and a max depth of 2 or higher for this tree will print the entire thing. So that's the trick. It's just an easy way to convert any recursive function into an iterative one. But I did want to finish by just pointing out one other issue with this code. Both the recursive and iterative solutions shown so far still suffer from high coupling. Namely, this function is actually doing two things. Number one, it's iterating over the tree of nodes. And number two, it's also operating on the data, in this case, printing out the nodes. If we wanted to do something else besides just print the node, we may end up copy-pasting this entire block of code only to change one line. As you can imagine, copy-pasting huge blocks of code just to change one line is discouraged. Instead, let's decouple these things by pulling out the part that does the iteration and making it a generator. Instead of actually doing anything with the node, let's just yield the node so that someone else can do something with it. Change the name, of course. Then we can implement our printing function just by iterating over the nodes and printing. Now neither the printing code nor the iteration code needs to know anything about each other, meaning they're completely decoupled, allowing you to plug in a different operation or a different order of iteration without rewriting or duplicating code. As far as functionality goes, of course, it's the same as it was before. But especially in larger projects, this is going to make your code much more testable and maintainable for the future. So just keep that in mind. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the trick and this video. If you did, don't forget to subscribe, and if you especially liked the video, please consider becoming a patron on Patreon. So thank you so much, and I'll see you next time.